All right, so does anybody know, have you ever heard of Lazarus Syndrome before? Who knows? Who's heard of it before? Good. I have no disclosures, except I am the proud father of two active duty Army soldiers, and I appreciate all your support out there. Whoever's watching on the internet, thank you for your support, and also our first responders. You know, we're sort of the first line after the first responders, and my hat's off to all you guys and gals. All right, so three objectives, short talk. Who's Lazarus? Define what Lazarus syndrome is, including potential mechanisms, and describe cases of Lazarus syndrome. And I'll let you in on a little secret. I actually had one of these happen to me, so it's kind of freaky. Anyway, so who's Lazarus? Those of you who subscribe to the Christian faith, Lazarus in the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John was the subject of a very prominent miracle. He was sick. Word was sent to Jesus, you need to come see your friend Lazarus. Jesus didn't show up in time. Lazarus died, was in the grave for 4 days. And then Jesus showed up, rolled back the stone, told Lazarus, come on out, and he walked out, still in his grave clothes. So using that name for the after-death resurrection, Lazarus has been used in a lot of different areas. It basically means resurrection to life. The Lazarus taxon, which I didn't know about until I worked on this talk, evidently there are organisms that are in fossil records that then disappear and then come back. And so they ascribe them to this this taxon. David Bowie has a song named Lazarus. It's kind of freaky. He's in bed, wrapped in all these like burial clothes, and it wasn't a very good song. I'd never heard it before. And then the Lazarus Effect was a movie, which if you see the picture down there, I don't know, she's kind of scary too. So I didn't watch that one. So what is Lazarus syndrome? It's rare, but very real. Probably underreported. Mine was not reported. But it is the delayed return of spontaneous circulation after cessation of cardiopulmonary resuscitation. So you're coding a patient for 20 minutes, 30 minutes, whatever, and then you stop, and you go about your business, you start charting, nurses are, and whoever is taking care of the patient, putting them in a body bag, and all of a sudden one of them says, hey doc, they're breathing. So it's also called auto-resuscitation after failed cardiopulmonary resuscitation. There are a total of about 38 cases that are published in 2007. I had one in my fellowship, and in flying home from TQIP last week, I talked to a colleague who's in a trauma center here in town, and they said, they just had one. So I said about 40, but two of them weren't reported yet. But on Grey's Anatomy in 2016, they had a patient who underwent 42 minutes of CPR after an acute myocardial infarction. 20 minutes later, patient's got a pulse. So I'm not a fan of Grey's Anatomy, but I will say that evidently there's this character here, Patrick Dempsey, who's got a nickname of McDreamy. After some arm twisting, I got the nurses in my hospital to call me O'Dreamy. So what's the mechanism? The only real plausible explanation is this phenomenon of auto-PEEP. So we all learned we do CPR. How many beats per minute are we supposed to be going? About 100, right? There's a couple songs, right? Another One Bites the Dust, Staying Alive, you know. Use either one of those for CPR. But what are our beloved RTs doing? Right? So they're not allowing the patient to fully expire that inhaled breath or that forced in breath. So the pressure inside the chest builds up exponentially. And so they think that maybe what happens is you have such intrathoracic pressure increases that blood is not getting back to the heart. So that's one possibility. Probably what happened in the case that I had many years ago. It's also a phenomenon of you're pumping drugs in the patient. Those of you who have been in codes with me, I'm like, give the last round. We're going to give 2 or 3 minutes of CPR. It works or it doesn't, you know, and then we call the code. But it could be that eventually the medicines catch up, you know, fire up those receptors, and then the heart restarts. Could be hyperkalemia. There have been reports of that. There's no hard and fast guidelines on how you're supposed to code patients, except, you know, ACLS, ATLS. But you probably should wait a good 60 seconds, a couple minutes, you know, after you call the code, just kind of sit there and watch, see what happens. And hopefully, you're not just putting the patient in the body bag and wheeling them off to the morgue, because some of the cases that are described are actually people waking up in the morgue in a body bag. And trust me, they got pretty hefty settlements from the hospitals that did that to them. But one thing that is suggested is monitoring end-tidal CO2 might be helpful, because if you're actually expiring CO2 during the expiration of your bagging the patient, their metabolic system is still running at some fashion. So end-tidal CO2 is probably a good thing for anybody that's intubated and or coding. So the cases, like I said, 38 published. Just going to give you two, actually, and then mine. 27-year-old man OD'd on heroin and cocaine, was given naloxone, actually walked to the ambulance, then got in the ambulance. What happens after you give naloxone? It goes away. He codes, gets 25 minutes of CPR, actually declared dead. About a minute later, return of spontaneous circulation. Guy made a full recovery. This lady's living in Fiji right now, you know, because she had a cardiac arrest, given multiple meds, electrical cardioversion, declared dead, put in a body bag, woke up in the morgue with a pulse. So I guarantee you, she's living in a nice desert island right now. My case, kind of sad. Mid-30-year-old female, went to Nashville. It was a girls' weekend, mother, two young children, backseat passenger of a Jeep, unrestrained, got tossed out of the Jeep. Had a significant TBI, CPR in progress. We coded her for a while. I called the code and I began working with, there were multiple patients, so I called the code, went over, started working on the other patients. Security guard comes up, hey doc, she's breathing. First I'm like, yeah, I'm busy right now, you know. He's like, no, she's breathing. So went back over there, restarted the code, actually got a pretty good set of vital signs. She ultimately was declared as brain dead due to her massive TBI and ended up donating. So it was, you know, I'd never heard of Lazarus syndrome until this case. So it was just fun to be able to turn something good out of something that was horribly bad. But it is published, like I said, 38 cases. The mechanism, motor vehicle crashes, AMIs, obstructive airway disease, are the predominant cases. So they're more medical as opposed to trauma. But ruptured AAAs, PA ruptures, GI hemorrhage, all, you know, there's a smattering of cases here and there. In 82% of the cases, return of spontaneous circulation came back within 10 minutes. They actually came in with asystole, PEA, and VFib, and then ultimately had ROSC. What I didn't know is 45% of these patients actually had a good neurologic outcome, and 35% actually went home with no neurologic sequela. So one-third of these patients walked out of the hospital. So Again, it's a little freaky if you ever see it. So in summary, Lazarus syndrome, very rare, but real. None of us have any training or degrees in resurrection. Disconnect the patient from the ventilator or from the ambu bag and let the auto peep sort of dissipate before you actually call the code. Observe the patient for about 10 minutes after stopping CPR. That's usually what happens. You're putting the patient in the body bag, you're, you know, doing other things. So hopefully you don't actually put someone in the morgue who ends up waking up. End-tidal CO2 is probably beneficial. A third of the patients actually survive with a neurologically good outcome. And from now on, you can all call me O'Dreamy. Now, having said that, there is an unnamed, well, I'll name it, the University of Monty Python, who had a trauma resuscitation. You don't want this to be your case in Lazarus syndrome.
Bring out your dead!
Here's one.
Ninepence.
I'm not dead.
What? Nothing. Here's your ninepence.
I'm not dead.
Here. He says he's not dead.
Yes, he is.
I'm not.
He isn't?
Well, he will be soon. He's very ill.
I'm getting better.
No, you're not. You'll be stone dead in a moment. Oh, I can't take him like that. It's against regulations.
I don't want to go on the cart.
Oh, don't be such a baby. I can't take him.
I feel fine.
Well, do us a favour.
I can't.
Well, can you hang around a couple of minutes? He won't be long.
No, I've got to go to Robinson's. They've lost 9 today.
Well, when's your next run?
Thursday.
I think I'll go for a walk.
You're not fooling anyone, you know. Look. Isn't there something you can do?
I feel happy! I feel happy!
Ah, oh, thanks very much.
Don't do that. Thank you for your attention.